All right, as you know, on Wednesdays, we're in our systematic theology series, and we've been covering the doctrine of salvation, soteriology. And for the last several weeks, I don't know how many weeks, but a long time, we've been dealing with the Calvinist view of salvation and why we do not subscribe to that. And part of that has been a logical defense, part of it's been a moral defense, part of it's been a philosophical defense, but it all comes down in the end to just a biblical view. What does the Bible say? And so we have to deal with the text that the Calvinists use, or at least the major ones that they use. And so we've been debunking for the last several Wednesdays different Calvinist proof texts. We've already dealt with Ephesians 1, Proverbs 21, but the ultimate proof text, of course, is Romans 9. And if you can't ever have a conversation with a Calvinist, but they're going to say, well, what about Romans 9? Okay, I got it. And so that is what I had intended to cover tonight. But I'm not going to for two reasons. See, what a setup and then a letdown. Sorry. I'm not going to for two reasons. First of all, because it is such an important text, then I want to be prepared to handle it properly. And I'm not quite finished with my preparation. I'm very close, but not quite. But then a second reason I'm not going to do it is because I myself and Brother Jed and a large number of our men are going to Men's Advance this weekend. And if you're not familiar with that event, Men's Advance, it's a wonderful time. We're going to Oklahoma, up to Stillwater. It's a great time of fellowship, great preaching, good food. It's a lot of fun. But it's designed, Men's Advance was designed to really challenge men to live up to the calling that God has placed on their lives, to be husbands and fathers and leaders in churches and so on and so forth. And so it's a very important time. They put a lot of work into preparing for it. And everything is designed to work together to help you understand the biblical truth that's trying to be communicated and to help that truth live in you and to resonate with you and to make a difference in your life. And so because of that, if we go with the right heart, it can be a time of revival. And not only personally, but also for a whole church. In fact, I know of many churches where that has taken place. And so when we're approaching an event like that, I thought an important question that we need to ask ourselves is just, in order to be ready for that, is do I need revival? Now, obviously, I realize not everyone's going to Men's Advance, but you can still ask yourself that question, do I need revival? There's no service, there's no time at which we don't need to ask ourselves that basic question. Am I really following and walking with God like I ought to be? And so I want to offer you tonight essentially three, we'll call them tests, which if the answer to any one is yes, then at least to that degree, you need revival, okay? And so the questions here are not just random or arbitrary or my own choosing. All three of these questions actually come from Jesus himself, and they're recorded in his letters to the churches in Asia. So I want you to open your Bible with me, please, very quickly to the book of Revelation and chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. All right, let's read in Revelation 2 and verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Let's pray, and we'll ask ourselves, do I need revival? Lord, I pray for this time when we're going to study your word together, and help our hearts just to be open and to honestly evaluate ourselves. It's probably not the case that there's some deep, dark, horrible sin going on that needs to be repented of and something like that. But God, we can just not be where we need to be. Not be where we once were. And we want to, if that's the case, we want to get back there. Or we want to make progress. We want there to be fresh life and joy in our Christian walk. And so we pray for that tonight and ask that you'll help us to see these things from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, here in these first seven verses, we have the church at Ephesus. And of course, this is an awesome church. I mean, there's no question. The church at Ephesus is awesome. They have several extremely positive qualities that every church, ours included, would do well to emulate. You'll notice here that Jesus commends them for their labor, their hard working. He commends them for their patience. They don't give up, right? They love the truth. They have disdain for evil. They're able to discern between those. They're able to see the people who claim to be apostles and are not, and recognize those people are liars. They're strong in the face of opposition. I mean, you just look at all the attributes of this church and think, wow, this is fantastic. If we had a church like that, we'd be so proud. And yet, there's this word in verse 4 that sounds an ominous tone. It's the word nevertheless. And that word reminds us that in spite of all the good things, there was a serious problem. They had left their first love. Now, I'll be honest, nobody, myself included, is completely certain what that phrase means. You can read into, there's a lot of people who have different opinions about it. Some think it refers to their zeal for evangelism. I don't think so. I doubt that completely. Others imagine a proud or critical spirit creeping in until there was no more love for each other, all right? So the love problem was horizontal, they say. And that's possible. And it's definitely something that we always want to guard against. We don't want there to be friction or problems in our church. That's the case. But I still don't think that's the issue. I personally believe it makes best sense to take it as a loss of love for Jesus himself, right? That's really what's going on. And you get that because the foundational commandment of both the Old and the New Testaments is what? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the Lord said in Mark 12 and verse 30, this is the first commandment. Our first priority is to put God first, right? So there's a good reason to think that this first love refers to Christ himself. Also, another reason for thinking that's the right answer is because in verse 1, you'll notice here that Jesus directs their attention to himself, to his centrality, to his authority. Notice he calls himself the one who holdeth the seven stars, right? It's about his authority, and who walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. That's his centrality, right? So that's a big clue. And as a church, these people had neglected Christ. They had neglected the one who should have been her priority, her first love. Dear friends, in any church, Christ is to be central. Right? He is to be the key figure. And so often people come to church and they're asking, well, how's the church going to minister to me today? Wrong question. Wrong question. It's not about us. It's about him. It's always to be about him. Right? He alone is worthy, and we should be worried. Our concern should not be, how's this going to help me? Our concern should be about putting him in the place of preeminence and giving him the praise and the worship that he deserves. Okay, now, you can almost hear somebody asking, well, how is it possible that a church as good as the one at Ephesus could fail to love Christ the way that they should? But I mean, just to ask that question is almost to answer it, isn't it? right? I mean, just stop and think about what happens in a marriage, okay? Lee is my first love. Amen. I like that. When I met her, I have witnesses that will testify to this. She was all I could think about, right? She was all I could think about. She consumed my time, my heart, my whole life. And if all of us that have been there, we know, right? I mean, this is true, okay? And so, but what happens after you've lived together for 25 or 30 or what is it now, 50-something, right? Or 70, 71 years? What happens? I'm not saying you don't still love one another, obviously, but the new wears off, right? The new wears off. The spark of excitement, if you're not careful, can grow weaker, right? And familiarity often becomes an enemy, doesn't it? Come on, it does, right? And it becomes hard to maintain the same degree of fire, we'll call it that. Lack of communication can cause your affection to wane, to cool off. The privileges of marriage get just taken for granted, right? And before you know it, even though the relationship is still intact and you're still going through all of the right motions, love itself has cooled off. Amen. Yeah. We all know what that's like. And unfortunately, the same thing that can happen in marriage can happen between us and the Lord Jesus, right? And you'll remember in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 2, Paul uses this same marriage imagery. And he says, we've been espoused, right, promised to Christ, as just like a woman is to her husband. But in Ephesus, that first, you know, flush of ecstasy had passed, and their early devotion to Christ had begun to wane or cool off, and they had fallen from the heights of their former devotion and descended into what John Stott calls the plains of mediocrity, right? And dear friends, that's a huge problem. That's a huge problem in our Christian walk. That there are a lot of good things about the church in Ephesus, but the most important thing, their love for Jesus, was no longer right. That was a problem. And that may be the case in our life too. So I would just say tonight that as part of our spiritual checkup, I would just ask you, look at your life, think about what's been going on, and ask, do you love Jesus the way you once did? Remember what it was like when you first got saved? And you wanted to spend as much time in the Bible, as much time in prayer, as much time around the people of God. You were so excited to learn about Him. I'm just asking, do you love Jesus the way you once did? And if not, there doesn't have to be something, you know, some horrible sin lurking in your life. But if we don't love Jesus the way that we once did, we need revival by definition. We need to be encouraged. We need to be provoked. We need to be stirred up to love Christ again. Now, there's a second test, and that actually comes from the first six verses of the next chapter. Let's go to chapter 3, please. And let's read about this church in Sardis. Notice what the Bible says. Unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. All right. In this letter, you'll notice here that it's not like the church at Ephesus. In church of Ephesus, there's just effusive praise over all these good things that they're doing. Here, Jesus has a couple good things to say about him, right? First, in verse 1, he says, I know thy works. Now, I realize that that same phrase is said about all the churches. It just is a statement of fact that Jesus knows what's going on in every church. But here, I think it's actually important because there were works. This was an active church. These people were busy. Okay? And that's a good thing. That's not a bad thing. Because especially when you look around the total, if you look at all churches, just on a scale, the vast majority of Christians and the vast majority of churches don't do anything for God. They don't do anything. They exist and that's it. All right? But this church, there were works. They were doing something. And those works were known to Jesus, and Jesus took knowledge of them. There's a second good thing that's said about them. We find that in verse 4, where Jesus says, Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. All right? So, even though it's not many people, there were a few who were being what they should be as Christians. They were separated. They were not defiled. They were still doing the right things. They had not succumbed, as it were, to the temptations and pressures of the world around them. And that's a big deal. It's a good testimony. That's a wonderful thing. Nevertheless, the point I want to make is how surprising it is that only a few people were doing right given their reputation. Did you notice that? Thou hast a few names that are doing good, but think about what their reputation was. The reputation of this church was very impressive. They had a reputation for life. Look at what it says. Thou hast a name, you have a reputation that thou livest. They were known for their life. All right? Now, we all know what a reputation is, don't we? A reputation is essentially what other people believe about you. That's a reputation. It's what other people believe about you. And when people looked at Sardis, they said, oh, man, there's life there. Those people are alive. That's a group that's really humming. Now, I'm not sure what people meant when they said that. I mean, we're not given a definition for life here. So what could it have been? Maybe this church was growing numerically. I mean, isn't that what most people think of when they think of life? They think the church is just exploding numerically. That's what most people think of. However, from the mention of their works, it's probably not, it may include that, but I think from the mention of their works, it's probably that they were life, people were calling it life because they were busy with activity. There was stuff going on there. All right? At Sardis, people were coming and going all the time. They were having choir practice and classes. They were going to, they were meeting to go places and taking kids to the park and taking senior citizens on the trip and taking the teens to camp. And someone was going somewhere and doing something all the time. There was a frenetic pace of things. Things were happening. Now, that's not bad in and of itself. Maybe they were busy also working on their property, or there was something going on. It's even possible that the term alive was used in reference to the services. I was dealing with a family yesterday who's wanting to join the church, and they said, we've been to all kinds of other churches around, checking them out. And he said, man, the people are engaged there. That's what they were talking about. So there's people all over saying amen, nodding their head and engaged, giving feedback. And maybe that's the case in Sardis. The people were loud. Maybe they clapped. Maybe they swayed. Maybe they raised their hands when they sang. I'm not sure how they got their reputation. All I know is they had that reputation. Their reputation was, we are alive as a congregation, but the reality was a totally different matter. They had a name that they were alive, but when Jesus looked, he could see there was really no life there at all. Right? They were dead. Right? Reputation had to do with what the other people believed about them. But Jesus knew what they actually were. And beloved, it's important for us to remember that it doesn't really matter what anybody else thinks about you. I mean, I want them to think nice things. okay? But it doesn't ultimately matter what other people think about us. They may think I'm a wonderful preacher. They may think this is a wonderful congregation. Boy, there's life there. People may have whatever impression they want, but it doesn't really matter unless Jesus thinks that. And Jesus is the one who knows the truth. And, you know, a person can hide stuff from their family, they can hide stuff from their friends, they can hide stuff from their coworkers, but you cannot hide anything from God. And so, you may have a good reputation, but Jesus knows the difference between reputation and reality. And when he says here, I know thy works, you can be sure that nothing has escaped his attention. The Bible says in Hebrews 4:12 that there is nothing that is not manifest in his sight. All things are naked and open under the eyes of him with whom we have to do. That's what the Bible says. Amen. Jesus knows. And when Jesus looked at Sardis, he said, at Ichabod. He stamped dead over the door. Right? And watch, because this is the key. At the end of verse 2, Jesus says, I have not found thy works perfect before God. Their works, in other words, fell short of the standard set by God, even though their works produced a good reputation in the eyes of others. They were meeting man's standards, but not God's standards. So think about this. If the world looks at a church and says, wow, there's life, that's awesome, and God looks at it and says, they're dead as a doornail, then it must be that Jesus is looking for a different kind of life than the world. They're not looking for the same thing. Jesus, if really the issue here was that they were, if what got them their reputation was all the things they were doing, then we have to conclude that Jesus must not be impressed with all of our hustle and bustle if that's all it is. In other words, I'm just saying that activity by itself is not the indicator of life that we sometimes think it is. The things that seem so important to man don't always amount to much in the eyes of God. God does want your work, but not until he first has your heart. Right? So what I'm saying is that your activity is not as important as your relationship. Right? Now, look, I know this sounds very similar to what we just dealt with at Ephesus in chapter 2, but it's actually distinct in this regard. You can define your Christian life in terms of your relationship with Christ, and yet you can allow that relationship to have cooled. That was the problem at Ephesus. But the problem at Sardis was worse because they actually had the wrong goal. Right? They were using the wrong standard to evaluate health. And they were basing it on their activity. Right? And so I just want to point out to you, the second test, first of all, we need to ask ourselves, do I love Jesus the same way, with the same fervor, the same intensity that I used to? And if not, then I need to get that right. I need to ask God to help me love him again. And secondly, you want to test whether or not we need revival? Here is the second test. If your Christian life has become defined by your activity for God rather than your relationship with God, you need revival. Amen. Amen. It's not about, well, man, I did this week and that this week and this. Okay, great. Those are good things. But it's not that those things by themselves don't impress God. We have to love God. We need to have, our focus needs to be on our relationship with him. And then there's a third and final test. And this test comes from the church in Laodicea. And I'm just saying, this church was pitiful, right? They're pathetic. This is not good. In fact, go over, look in chapter 3 again. Look down in verse 15. Jesus talking about the church in Laodicea, and he makes their condition painfully clear. Jesus says, I know thy works, And here's their works. You are neither cold nor hot. Now I wish you were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Oh man, this is so funny. The Greek words that are translated cold and hot here, we need to make sure that you understand this. These are not just your average terms. These are extremes, okay? Cold is very cold here. We're talking like dawn in January. I mean, it's cold. Hot is scalding hot, so hard you can barely stand it. Now, what do these extremes, super cold or really hot, what do those things signify? Now, I've taught this before, but I want to make sure that you remember this, because we've heard this our whole life. Typically, we think of this like two ends of a scale, with cold signifying deadness, right? This church has no life, no activity, no nothing. They're just dead. And on the other hand, we think of hot as signifying life and vitality, right? There's something wonderful going on. You're in love with Jesus. You're serving God, and it's based upon, it's an outflow of your relationship with Christ. All these things are so this church is on fire. They're hot. This church is cold. They're not doing anything. That's what we typically think of. Okay, and then lukewarm would be someplace in the middle, where you know you're just kind of coasting. But I want you to stop and ask yourself, is it really true that God, or that Christ here, would prefer a church that is as dead as the nails in a coffin as compared to one that's just average? Right? Would God prefer... Let's use woke as a substitute for dead. Would God prefer a woke church to just, you know, your run-of-the-mill Southern Baptist church that's not really doing anything? Do you think that God would prefer that? Is it? Is that what it says? Now, the reason I bring this up is because I know we've been taught that our entire life. And I'm not trying to upset your apple cart. Yes, I am, I guess. The answer to that is no, God would not prefer this to that. That's not what's being said. Okay, I know you've heard that your whole life, but it's wrong. Okay? And here's why it's wrong. Laodicea, now, we believe, let me just stop here and remind everybody, we believe... At our church, we practice what is called LGH hermeneutics. We believe in literal, grammatical, historical hermeneutics. You cannot divorce the interpretation of the text from its natural meaning, its literal meaning, from the grammatical considerations. If it uses a singular or a plural, that's significant, right? Whatever grammatical considerations are found in the text, those mean something. Nor can you divorce it from its historical context, right? We have to interpret it in light of what the history was and what was going on, okay? Now, let's apply that H part of our hermeneutic to this story. Laodicea was part of a three-city area, okay? There were three cities that made up the greater Laodicean metropolis. Those three cities were Colossae, Laodicea in the middle, and Hierapolis. Okay? Right? Hierapolis, Laodicea, Colossae. Three cities. Now, the explanation for this phrase, this you're lukewarm, all right, that has to do with the water supply of those three cities. Now, we know exactly how this works. We've dug it up. We have the piping and the aqueduct, the whole thing to substantiate this, okay? We know exactly what was going on. The city of Colossae sprang up first, right? And the reason it came up first is because it had a defensible position and it had an endless supply of water. There was a really good well there, a really good spring, actually. Now, water was the critical factor in antiquity, right? And in the case of Colossae, their water supply was just perfect. Most cities relied, in that day, most of them had warm mineral springs, right? How many of you have ever been to, like, Sulphur Springs, Oklahoma. Okay? What does it smell like? It don't smell good. Can you drink it? Yes. Will it kill you? No, but it's, you might wish, all right? Okay? It stinks like rotten eggs. Okay? So a lot of these places had warm mineral springs. Can you imagine having to rely on warm mineral water? That would not be good. But Colossae didn't have that. They had an ice cold spring that gushed with mineral free water. It was awesome. Everybody loved it. Okay? So compared to everywhere else around, this was a honey hole. Colossae had perfect water situation. Hierapolis, on the other hand, they were located 15 miles away up on a hillside. You can go look on the internet tonight and see this. It's still there, right? And they had the exact opposite situation from Colossae, right? Their water that came up out of the ground was not cold or mineral-free. It was almost boiling hot. And it was full of all these healing minerals. And as you can well imagine, they had done the same thing with that spring in their day that we would do in our day. What would we do if we had a really nice, really hot spring coming up out of the ground? What would we do with it? Huh? You'd have a spa, right? That's exactly what we would do. You'd go to Colorado and you'd have Glenwood Springs and all this hot water and everybody, they build a hotel around it, they make a huge swimming pool and everybody goes there. That's exactly what they had done. They turned it into something of a resort area and they called it, there was a name for it. It was called Pamukkale, which means the cotton castle. And the reason they called it that was because after the spring came boiling out of the ground and as the water flowed down the hillside and the minerals began to settle out of it, it turned the entire hillside white. And it looked like, constantly, year-round, it looked like it was laying there under a blanket of freshly fallen snow. Or cotton, they called it the Cotton Castle for that reason. Right? And people came from everywhere who were sore and had ailments. They came from everywhere hoping to find relief in those natural hot springs. All right? So you got the cold water in Colossae, super hot water in Hierapolis, and in the middle, guess what you got? Right? Laodicea is in the middle. Hierapolis is up on the hillside. Water runs down to Laodicea. And, you know, these two extremes, Hierapolis on the one side and Colossae on the other, they're blessed, right? They got good water for one purpose or another. Laodicea doesn't have that. Laodicea is sitting on the main arteries, the main interstate system, so to speak, and so they got a lot of wealth. They're blessed with prestige and prosperity, but their water was terrible. Because it was below them in elevation, Laodicea got its drinking water from an aqueduct that started up in Hierapolis. But by the time the waters from those hot mineral springs had traveled nearly 10 miles down the mountain to their town, it had cooled off quite a bit. And now, those waters, when they got to Laodicea, were not hot anymore. They were just lukewarm. But they're still full of stinky minerals. They stank and they tasted terrible. So you can see how Jesus' criticism here would make perfect sense to them. Is everybody following me? Jesus is telling the church in Laodicea, he's like the water in your town, you are lukewarm and disgusting. God says, Jesus says, I wish you were either a life-giving drink of fresh, cold water like they have in Colossae, or at least a healing hot mineral bath like they have in Hierapolis, but because you are neither refreshing nor healing, you're not good for anything. See, it's not that one is bad and the other's really good. No, it's that both of these, the extremes, are good. And in the middle, they're neither cold and refreshing, nor are they hot and healing. They're just, ugh. You're nauseating, Jesus says. And I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Is everybody with me tonight? Now, there are two acceptable extremes. In other words, what Jesus is telling them, they could either be cold or hot, because either way, they would be useful and helpful. What they can't be is half-hearted and good for nothing. Jesus is not going to tolerate them being indifferent and apathetic and lackadaisical because it makes them useless. And friends, the same thing is true today. Jesus wants us to be engaged. He wants us to be useful, not half-hearted. Everybody say amen right there. That's what he's looking for. We are either supposed to be hot or cold, but never just lukewarm. Okay? Now, wait a second. Does that mean that he expects us to be some sort of gospel freaks? Some sort of fanatics? Well, I guess it depends on what you mean by fanatic. How do you define that? Okay? I'll tell you how the dictionary defines it. The dictionary defines a fanatic as someone characterized by excessive enthusiasm, unreasoning zeal, or wild and extravagant notions on some subject. All right? So we could say it this way. A fanatic is all in, but they've let their heart run away with their head. All right? Jesus does not want that. Okay? He's not asking for that. He does want people, though, who are passionate and wholehearted. Okay? He wants people that have thought deeply and reflected on what it means to be a disciple, and then with a clear-eyed commitment, he wants them to have dedicated their life to following him. And so if you think that's a fanatic, well then yes, Jesus wants fanatics. But I think the better term is just he wants disciples. What Jesus desires and deserves is a people who are fully engaged and on fire for him. And God has always put a premium on passion and a penalty on half-heartedness. Remember through Isaiah in the Old Testament? And then again through Jesus in the New Testament, God rebuked his nation with these words. He said, "This people draweth nigh to me with their lips, with their mouth, but their heart is far from me." Man, it ticks God off when his people are not passionate about pursuing him. He wants his people to put their entire soul into their worship, all their might into their service for him, and real love into their relationship with him. So I would just say tonight, the last part of the spiritual checkup is this. If your pursuit of God, right, if your passion for God has grown lukewarm, well, then you need revival. It's really not hard. We can just summarize the whole text this way, all right? What's the world in front of this text? What is Jesus, what picture is he painting for what is ideal in his churches? Well, in the ideal world, number one, our love for Jesus never wanes, right? We're continually in love with him. Our love with him is growing deeper and deeper and deeper as the years go by. Number two, our spiritual life is defined, right, by a thriving relationship with Christ, not frenetic activity for Christ. Doesn't mean you shouldn't have activity, but it should be the overflow. It should be the result of our relationship and our connection with him. He wants us to abide and then bear fruit, right? And then third, our service for God is wholehearted and useful to do something for him. So be honest with yourself tonight. I mean, just do an evaluation. You want this to be a good year? You want this to be a great men's advance? You want to get the most out of it? It starts with a realistic and accurate diagnosis. And Jesus has here in these three churches laid out some symptoms. And if you have one or especially all three of them, then we just need to come and take the first step on the road to revival. Let's just come and ask God, "Lord, I want to recover. I want to get back the passion. I want to rekindle my love for you. I want to make sure that I'm focused on my relationship with you, and then that I'm putting my heart and my soul into my efforts to serve you." Those three things. Let's stand together. Lord, we love you tonight, and we're thankful for your word and thankful for how clear and simple and beautiful it is. And Lord, even though these things are easy to understand, they're very hard to do. It's easy for our love to grow cold. It's easy for us to define our relationship with you in terms of all the things that we're doing. I mean, Martha was that way, cumbered about with much serving. But the thing that was most needful, that time spent abiding and in relationship with you, was missing. And Lord, it's easy, on the other hand, to just go through life not really doing anything, to not be passionate about our service for you. To not be passionate about, I mean, we're so passionate about sports or about our job or about this, that, or the other thing, but not about you. When it comes to spirituality, we're just lukewarm. There's no real burning zeal on the one hand. We're not refreshing to be around from others because of our passion for you, Lord. So I pray that you'd help us just to look at ourselves and honestly acknowledge, Lord, I need to step it up here. And God, we can't just grit our teeth and do that. It comes from surrender. We have to come and acknowledge where we've gotten off track and just ask you to forgive and restore. And so we pray for that tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.